Hello and welcome to Innovation Oxford. I'm your host, Mike Harding. Today, we're in Tillsonburg at Townsend Lumber, and we're going to learn how they take logs and make them into things this thick, and also these kinds of products behind me. And to do that, we're going to meet the owner of Townsend, and that's Dave Townsend. How are you?
I'm very well.
Where are you going to take us?
We're going to show you through log yards, sawmills, dry kilns. We're going to have you in the warehouses. We're going to show you all of our different products we make here on site.
Fantastic. Let's go.
All right.
Do you call this logging, lumber, timber? What do you call it, this business you're in?
Well, we're in the sawmill business primarily. That's our main business. So to do that, you need to buy timber. You have to buy standing timber from landowners, farmers, and get all the infrastructure together, get it marked properly by a forester, get all the approvals from the county. Then we hire a crew to cut it and skid it.
Let's go look at some of the timber that you've got here. But how long have you been in this business?
Mostly 55 years.
Yeah? You must have joined a business when you were like three.
When I was 10. Actually.
When you were 10. And it was your dad's business?
Dad started it out, yep. And I helped him immediately starting as a teenager.
Yeah?
And as time went on, that was my actual full career. I went to lumber grading school in Memphis, Tennessee, way back when I was like 20 years old. And I've taught all the men here how to grade lumber.
So these have been here, what, a couple of years now? Or?
No. There's nothing in this yard, as a rule, that ever is longer than 1 year.
So you don't have to sort of, what do you call it? I mean,
just in time?
Yeah.
In the heat of the summer, we have to cut white woods within 3 weeks for the time the tree's cut down.
Really?
In the heat of the summer. In the fall, winter, and spring, we can keep inventories for a number of months. But the white woods start to deteriorate and get stained in them almost immediately when the tree is cut.
Even I can see that there's a change happening here with this wood. What is this wood we're seeing here?
These are cherry logs.
Wow.
And they're some of the larger but low-grade logs. So they'll be sorted and they'll be cut for a specific job.
What about the ones that have sort of black bottom and the black ends on them?
That's red and white oak. And they're also low-grade, large logs. And they have to be kept, and they have to be cut into special industrial products to get enough money back out of what we paid for them.
Right. And so you pay per stem, per tree, huh?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And so if I owned a wood lot, I'd be talking to you?
Yeah. For yeah, sure. One of my guys. We're FSC rated.
What's that mean?
Forest certification products.
Okay. Yeah.
We're doing all the standards that are necessary to comply with Rainforest Alliance audit. And that's just fairly recently in the last 6 months.
What is the purpose of that organization? To make sure that things are sustainable?
Yeah, you're doing things in a perfectly ethical, acceptable manner according to their audit system.
Has that become important for people in your business?
Yes.
Yeah.
I believe we're one of the first people in all of like Southern Ontario, at least, to get FSC qualification.
All right. And yeah. So if I'm a woodlot owner, do you actually harvest the material yourself?
We subcontract that.
Yeah, and so there are good people and bad people when it comes to harvesting your woodlot?
Well, some people do a better job than others. A lot of people like to just come in and cut a few good trees and leave, but that is not what managing a woodlot's all about.
No, and are you finding that there's greater standards in terms of how you harvest from a woodlot?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
What's
cutting bylaws have improved a lot in the last 50 years.
So this place is filled with logs, and it begs the question, are we running out of lumber?
No.
Why not?
No, I think we've got a pretty evenly balanced inventory in our 4 or 5 county area here because we have good tree cutting bylaws. The majority of people now know enough to get some professional help like ourselves to manage their woodlot, because a woodlot owner has to lay out absolutely zero revenue. And if they do it properly, you're looking at a decent harvest like every 8 years. Because you got to go in, like I said, and get a few of the bigger ones out. They're mature, but you also got to get out the unwanted species. They're going to use up all that air and oxygen and ground. So get them out.
I mean, the woodlot is there to harvest, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
And can you sustainably harvest wood?
Oh, yeah. Our bushes overplant themselves. That's why you have to go in there and work, because you'll have like 10 or 15 seedlings pop up and only two will ever make it to maturity.
How many years go by before you got a tree you can harvest?
Oh, if you count the rings on the average tree in here, it's probably about 60 years. Maybe
60
some
years.
Would be down to 50.
Are softwoods less time than hardwoods?
They're pretty similar, very similar. We encourage people to grow hardwood because it's worth so much more money. It's worth four to five times the money.
As you can imagine, there's a lot of sawdust in the sawmill. There's a market for this that they take advantage of. But we'll be right back after 90 seconds here at Townsend Lumber Mills. You know, it's a really great job that every child would want to have, and that's the debarker. That's a real mean-looking piece of equipment. But I also learned a new word to describe a job here. Something, a saw what?
A sawyer. A head sawyer. They're the ones that control the carriage to saw the log into lumber.
So that's what we're going to meet when these logs go into your sawmill. So this is your head sawyer.
This position is head sawyer. Yeah, he rotates with the resaw man and the edger man. The three of them are a team because they have to all be thinking on the same wavelength with the same game plan, just like a lot of other teamwork. It's a double cut bandsaw. So we're cutting in both directions.
That's the
screen on the scanner. We have a scanner up in the ceiling that scans every log so we can get the best recovery out of every log. We put that in pre-recession. That's been in about 8 or 9 years now. And it helps us get a slightly better yield out of every log.
So you invested in this technology to do what?
To get more out of every log, and it enables us to actually process about 10% more logs per shift because it takes away some of the mundane work that the sawyer normally has to do. This machine automatically tapers the log, and it also helps you at your set point. It'll make sure that the face of that slab has got just enough to make a grade.
Mm-hmm.
So you're picking up time and recovery and less fatigue for the operator. Those are the three main things. So like I say, instead of sawing 300 logs a shift, we're maybe up to 330 logs a shift, depending on the size and the length. And that's how all those cameras are looking at it. And like I said, it feeds two 486 high-speed computers in here. It gives it the data. And then it's all about the hydraulics and the cylinders on the machine that actually set the taper.
All right, and so he watches. He the sawyer makes a decision. What kind of decision making is he looking for?
He's turning the log to what he feels is the best face, because we're going to have four faces, because that round log is going to be in a rectangle. And again, if you don't approach the defects in the log the proper way, you'll get lower valued lumber out of a log than you will if you actually truly position it properly.
Now, this software is not cheap, is it?
No.
You know, what did it set you back?
We spent the better part of $360,000 on this system about 8 years ago.
So, you mean, you've got to be fairly large to be able to afford something like this.
Yeah, you wouldn't put this in a small little hit-and-miss sawmill because you'd never get your money out of it.
Give me the one-minute lesson on grading.
Oh.
So this is all cherry.
This is all cherry.
So this one is what?
This is a two-inch plank, and we call it 8/4.
Yeah.
Because it's 2 inches plus a quarter inch for the drying factor. Whereas this board is what we call a 4/4. That's also 1 inch plus an eighth of an inch for drying factor. And when we dry lumber, we also lose 7% of all the width of it all.
All right, so it does shrink.
Oh, yeah.
And so when you look at it, you say something like this is going to be used for what?
When I look at it as a grader, I see what is usable in that board.
Yep.
I see the defects, but I'm looking around it. I'm looking for rectangles to utilize the good solid wood on it. Because we have five basic grades. And it has to be 83%, 67%, 50%, 33%, or 25%.
And so you have to do all that just by sight, right on the spot.
Well, it's automatic. It's like riding a bicycle.
Is it?
When you look at it, it pretty well tells you what it is.
And so tell me about use. Where are they going to be used?
The poorer boards like this one will probably end up, because that's a grade 2 and 3. That'll probably end up in our flooring plant. We'll make flooring out of that. Whereas if you have a better board like this select, we'll sell that to the furniture industry, or it'll be shipped overseas. They'll do some other remanufacturing, possibly. Or we also do some trim and moldings of our own.
So it's marked, what, S for select?
S for select.
And 1?
This is a 2.
It's only got one mark, though.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
It's just a code.
Yeah, and so these are also not as good as the board we just saw?
Correct, yep, yep.
These and something like this. What are you going to do with that
board? That's typical. That's an outside board off of a big log. It's cherry, but it's white because the first 6 years of growth on the tree that we get into is all sapwood. After about 6 or 7 years, it turns into a dark color like hardwood.
All right.
Because the minerals collected in it by then.
All right. So the early stage, it's a white color, and then it gets to the cherry we recognize. Why is this board so thick?
Because the thicker, high-grade boards are worth more money than the ones. So you try to maximize your yield out of a log, not only in board feet, but also in dollar value.
And so here's this looks like a really good one, is it?
That's the big log we just watched in there a few minutes ago. That was like a 33-inch log.
Yeah.
Right? So we'll get a lot of big planks out of that. This could end up being table legs or some heavier trim or moldings.
So that'll be sold to the furniture business?
Yes.
Yeah.
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 For sure. Yeah.
Are these saws ready to use?
Yes.
Now, they're not the kind of band saw that I recognize.
Well, they're 12 inches wide and they're 36 feet long. And that's what we've always used in this sawmill. There's two of these big machines running. One's on the head saw and one's on the resaw.
All right. And this is somebody's job here, isn't it?
Yep. Brian is the filer of the filing room.
So you are, Brian over here, you're responsible. You're responsible for making these things. Hi, I'm Michael.
How you doing?
To making these things actually saw, huh?
Yep.
What's the biggest problem with them when they arrive on your doorstep?
Well, they get lumps in them, and then you got to hammer the lumps out. Got to keep the swedge up on them and keep a good gullet.
And you like have to saw the edges or file the edges?
We grind them on the grinder. I bench them, and I put them on there, and then I grind them.
All right.
And then after they get down where the teeth gets down a little shorter, you re-swedge it, bring them back up, shape it.
Do they ever wear out completely?
Well, after we get down about 11 inches, we knock the swedge off one side and run them on the resaw.
Nothing goes to waste here, I hear.
Or I can cut the teeth off, but I usually just leave them on.
All right.
There's a huge...
Okay, what is it you found in it?
...knocked out of the log. We hit that with the saw up here and cut it right off and smashed a bunch of teeth. There's an actual stone.
In the wood.
Somebody's picked it up, probably put it in the crotch of the tree or on a small limb when it was little.
And the tree eventually wraps around it.
And they were supposedly going to go back, and they were going to pick it up, throw it away. Old insulators. We just hit a pile of those.
Spikes.
Yeah, these are real beauties. Railway spikes.
In a tree.
Yep. Yep.
Hidden from view.
Yep. 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 Yeah, quite often if we're lucky something big like this, we'll see it in the debarker. The debarker will hit the end of it and shine up.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, crank.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, we shouldn't
these be... These were the ones that were the worst for years, sap spiles.
Yeah.
What are these called?
Sap spiles.
Sap?
For maple.
Oh,
maple
right,
syrup.
For maple. They'd be in the tree and then the tree would gradually wrap around them.
Yeah, and then there's all the people that make their own out of steel pipe and copper pipe and cast pipe.
Yep.
They drive them in the tree, and then they can't pull them out, so they just leave them. So 40 years later, we hit them.
And you hit them with one of these?
Yep.
And I get it. I guess it complains.
Oh, yeah.
So, Dave.
Yeah.
Tell me about these.
Those are the horseshoes. Those are in the larger category of what we've hit over the years. Normally, we hit small stuff like this, sap spiles and bolts and nails and clothesline hooks. But these are two of the more classic. That's why we kept these. These are actual horseshoes that were inside of logs. And when we either hit them with the debarker or the head saw, so we had to stop, chop the log off, take the saw off. Sometimes they're totally ruined. Sometimes they're still fixable.
Didn't bring you much luck, did it?
No, the horseshoe didn't bring me any luck, no.
We'll be right back after the brief message. Stay tuned. More innovation to come. Tell us about your overheads. How do they compare to your competition?
Well, I belong to National Hardwood Lumber Association, and I've talked to many other mill operators because we actually belong to some of the U.S. associations. And from what they tell me, their property taxes and a lot of their other utility bills are quite often half of what ours are.
So the cost of being in business means that you have to be more productive?
Yeah, I try to be more productive, and obviously you just don't show as much profit in your business. I mean, the overhead's overhead. You can't change it much.
Now, you don't ship much to the United States, am I correct?
No, not as much as we used to, no.
Yeah, and what's changed?
Oh, the offshore market has changed the whole North American manufacturing process, I would say. like a lot of this wood used to be used, you know, anywheres in all of Eastern North America, and now quite a bit of it has to be shipped offshore, go to Asia.
To be processed, made into things?
Yeah. A lot of the factories moved over there. The big guys, a lot of them moved over there.
And this wood is?
This is walnut right here.
How long will it stay parked here before it gets used?
This was cut fresh and green in the sawmill just a few weeks ago, and we left it piled tight, and we put it in a steam kiln for a full week at like 100°C, live steam in there, and that gets the actual white wood, sapwood, dark like the heartwood, so because they want a consistent color in the walnut. Because yes, it's fairly pricey, but they do not want it dark and white and dark.
Now, in case people have noticed, I mean, there's no of those, what do you call those?
Slats.
No. Slats.
No.
Yeah, and so it can be.
It's wet lumber. We want it to stay wet so the heat can penetrate it, and the pigment and the color and the heartwood transfers into the sapwood.
Okay, so how long is this wood going to be here before it can be used or shipped out?
It's going to be put on slats, and it'll go through the drying process within just a matter of days. It just came out of the steam kiln just a couple of days ago.
Somehow I never thought of lumber as being a just-in-time thing. You know, you want, because time, I guess, is money.
Well, there's a lot of costs of converting a tree into usable kiln-dried lumber for an end use. It almost doubles the price of the raw material.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, you got to cut, skid, truck into the yard, saw it, maybe go through the steaming process, and or put it all on lath, air dry it, move it into a kiln for a week, up to 3 months. The thicker woods take 3 months.
3 months. Yeah.
Yeah. 84 millimeter oak takes 4 months, actually.
Of course, your profit is sitting in the wood, isn't it?
Yeah.
You've got to sell it.
Yeah. We actually only turn our inventory about every 9 months, some of it.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I'm here with Zach Bugner. And Zach, how long have you been here?
I've been here about 11 months now.
And what was the fascination with lumberyard?
Honestly, it's a very unique industry, and it's, I do a lot of hobby woodwork on my own, so it's something that interests me on a personal level as well as a professional level.
So as a hobbyist, I mean, do you get, like, free wood?
No. I wish. That'd be nice, but...
You went to university here. What university?
I went to the University of Western Ontario.
To study?
As a Bachelor of Business Management Organizational Studies.
I think that would apply here, wouldn't it?
Very much so, yes.
What do you bring to the table here?
Well, hopefully I bring some new ideas as well as some analysis tools that I gained while I was at school, and, I mean, the ability to learn a lot of what's going on here, because most of the people in the industry have been here 20 years, that kind of stuff, so they know absolutely and everything, just need to pass it on to the next guys to take over.
Yeah, so they're aging out, but isn't there a book you can go read about this business?
Well, that would be the easy way, but no one's managed to write that just yet.
And so you've come here, and you grew up in Tillsonburg?
Yep, I grew up outside of Brownsville, and have kind of made my way into town since then.
All right, and did you have a fascination with wood, you know, when you were a kid growing up?
Yeah, a little bit. Started woodworking with my dad when I was about 13 or so. And
so this was a natural for you.
Oh.
You know, I hear that there's the resting place we got to see now, and that's where this wood goes to rest, right?
Yes.
Yeah, Dave told us, you know. Mm-hmm. All right, we'll go right now.
All right. Green state before we put it in the kilns to kiln dry it. It just kind of balances it out and allows it to equalize.
What do you mean by equalize?
So at the very center of the board, it'll be much more moist, a much higher moisture content than what's on the outside of the board, and you also have bound and unbound water. So what you want to do is let it sit for a little while and kind of just equalize, balance itself out, much more slowing down the drying process a lot more. And then when you put it in the kiln, you can speed it up and take it down that much faster.
So this is acclimatizing?
Yeah, that'd be a good word for it.
Yeah, and so if you put it in the kiln too early, what happens?
It'll split, it'll checker, you'll end up with all kinds of defects in the wood.
Ooh.
So like a split would be a wide gap where it literally just blows apart. A checker is actually more on the inside where the grains of the wood have just kind of opened up a little bit, and it degrades the lumber significantly. So if you were to put a kiln of 8-quarter red oak, you know, it's a $100,000 kiln worth of wood, and all checkers, it's worth $20 firewood. It's nothing. So you want to be very
There
careful.
Would be a whole lot of heavy-duty blame going around.
Yeah, maybe a little bit. Yeah,
yeah
you
yeah.
don't want to ruin a kiln of that.
I lose $100,000. So after here, where does it go?
So from the breaking wall here, either it'll be air-dried material that we process into industrial-grade material like our breeze-dried sticks or our pallet pre-cuts, or it'll go into one of our 13 dry kilns that we've got on site.
So that's where the wood goes
yep.
to rest. So Dave, you... you think that this is the most valuable lumber on the lot. It's ash.
Yep.
It comes from trees that are still alive,
yep,
but are facing disease.
Correct.
And it's what makes it valuable?
The thickness,
yeah,
and the grade. I mean, it's 3 1/4 inches thick, and it's selected better lumber.
And where is it bound for? What's this going to be used as?
Well, this came from our sawmill in Kitchener called Kitchener Forest Products. That's why it's got a K on the sticker. And it's on breeze-dried sticks, which I invented 25 years ago. And now that it's been air-dried for about a week or so, it's going to go into a kiln, and that'll be kiln-dried for probably the better part of at least a month before it's stable. So when it comes out, it'll be a usable bunch of lumber.
What are you going to make on one of these? I mean, what's it going to sell for?
That lift of lumber is probably the better part of 1,000 board feet because there's a lot of airspace in it. And it's probably worth about $1,900, that lift.
Not bad. So this is an example of the kind of wood product you'll find at Townsend. This is in the retail section. This piece of red oak is perfect piece all the way to the end. They're going to use it on a bar. That's a kind of select product that can be grown right here in Oxford County in the region. We'll be right back with more innovation. Stay tuned. This is a specialized mill here. What is the purpose of this particular mill?
This mill was designed to take care of the small diameter logs and the lower grade wood that we accumulate when we're doing good forestry in a woodlot, because half of the trees we cut deserve to go to our big mill and be cut into lumber for more valuable things. We are now converting our money into finished products here. So we help your woodlot get rid of a bunch of low-grade logs so the good ones can grow. So we got money into them. We've converted them here into pallet and crate lumber for making, like, mostly shipping. It's for shipping. Boxes or crates.
Can you actually make money by growing trees?
You certainly can. A well-managed woodlot can produce as much revenue as any average cash crop with zero input costs. Because all of us forestry people will do all the work, and you'll receive value for whatever we remove.
Everything we've seen on this site, first of all, how many acres is it?
You've looked at most of 200, but we utilize about 100 acres
in the
process.
And you've been here since 1984. And before that, it was all tobacco field?
It was just vacant land, yep.
Yeah, so
totally vacant.
We have people interested in how you stay in business. What, you know, been through the recession.
Yeah.
You've had markets drop out, and yet you're still alive,
yeah,
still working hard.
Yeah.
What are the key elements that help you stay in business?
For us, and actually Townsend Lumber, we've got a real good staff that knows what they're doing, because mm-hmm, we know how to properly utilize logs. We've got a highly diversified base of raw materials.
So you don't make just 2x4
species. No. We're really not in the 2x4 business at all. And mixed species and mixed variety of needs by customers, because yes, one day we're cutting a lot of heavy construction wood, maybe for the seaway or for a construction job in downtown Toronto, and the next day we're cutting cherry like we were today, and it's mostly grade lumber for furniture, flooring, trim, moldings,
and just
some of it's export, some of it's here for our own reman. It's a real mix. It's a very, very mixed product line we make here.
And the business has changed since you actually went to your dad's, worked on your dad's sawmill, and of course a sense of innovation too in terms of the technology.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's how you stay in business. For Innovation Oxford, I'm Mike Harding. Thanks for joining us. See you next time.